I want to talk about this, and this work is totally not possible without other people's work, like Lex and Rens and Jose and Jack. So, and I want to like to thank the organizing committee for having the opportunity to talk here. So this presentation, it's about from land to sea, all processes from source to impact on a global scale. What do I mean with nutrients? That's nitrogen and phosphorus. There was also the word hydrology in the title. The hydrology is our medium to transport the nutrients through the landscapes. So that's important. And I'm going to show some results from the 20th century because we think that the accumulation of phosphorus in soils and sediments is an important factor. As we know, from 1970, the Baltic and the Black Sea, they encounter a lot of eutrophication problems. So that's why we're trying to do this. So my presentation is very simple. Small introduction. I want to present some examples of ecological concepts, of models. And then I want to give some presentation of the modeling of the in-stream biochemistry and some future activities. So first, let's start with the results because that's why we do it. And I already have done that. There's time left for the rest. So in 2000, we calculate there was a time of 37 million tons of nitrogen going to the coast and almost 4 million tons of phosphorus going to the coast. But how does it come there? Can we explain that? Where does it come from? So you saw in the sheets from Pat Glibbert that, for example, fertilizer use is about 100 tons. So only 37 reaches the coast. Where is that? So the mean of the biggest media are the rivers of the world. So those rivers, they are very different between rivers. So if you compare the Amazon and the Danube, for example, you see the Amazon is about three times longer than the Danube. It has an area which is, I think, 8 or 10 times bigger. But the population is much smaller. And also where the people live, mostly in cities in the Amazon river basin, instead of in the Danube where they live a little bit urban and rural. So also within the river basin, there's a lot difference in the landscapes. If you're looking at the source of the Rhine, for example, this is the Rhine you see here. There you see that, for example, here there are mountains. This is an area where a lot of people working industry, and you have the Netherlands around here, which is very flat. So there are all kinds of other things and processes happening through the scale. To understand this a little bit more, I want to show some figures, schematic figures, taken from Bauman et al. 2013. It handles about nutrient dynamics, transfer and retention along the aquatic continuum from land to ocean. I think this paper is very helpful if we have a discussion about model concept, or it handles all kinds of concepts, and also for the processes, the timescale and spatial variety between that. And what you see here, this is, so there are 4 or 5 different zones. So you have the groundwater compartment, you have the riparian zone, you have the small streams, you have an urban area, and you also have rivers, which also means like lakes and reservoirs of water bodies. And all these zones, they retain fractions of nutrients. And you also see this part is where vegetation takes place. That could be natural, but also agricultural vegetation. And leaching in the groundwater, there's a lot of, for example, nitrogen retained in this part. The interflow, the runoff, a lot of things where nutrients are retained. And of course, the atmospheric deposition is not only on the ditches, but also on the rest of the landscape. And for example, wastewater treatment is going directly into the big rivers, like the same holds for example, aquaculture, for example. So these four concepts are distinguished in this paper from Bowman et al. And I want to give examples of these concepts and have some specifics about it. So I want to start with the first one is a very it is focused on the in-stream processes, and of course this is only nitrogen, but I mean a lot of other components like phosphorus and other forms. And what you generally see in this kind of models is that there's a lot of attention on the in-stream processes, but they take the one-factor analysis for direct inputs from soil to water. An excellent example of this is the River Stoala model from Vincent. So with that, I can skip this one. So that's so another approach is the lumped regression approach. The general idea of this is to have this kind of river basin, have kind of nutrient sources, like, for example, agricultural land. You can aggregate that to one value per river basin. So you have 50% agricultural land, 30% water area. All those factors that influence, that can explain the export to the coastal sea. And then you use a calibration method to create this model. Now one of the examples is the global news models. You see here the DIN model with the measured DIN on the horizontal axis and the modeled DIN of this model on the vertical axis. That looks nice. So, but the problem with this is that the variation between the river basin is not taken accounted for. You can't find this. So I think that John later will introduce this models, so I can skip that as well. So so here we have a distributed model with focus on delivery processes. This is typically a model which is done by terrestrial ecosystem modelers, like the River Stoala model is done by the aquatic ecosystem modelers. So I want to show some examples. So there's a lot of time and effort going into the processes in the soil, in the groundwater, riparian area sometimes, and they use one fraction to use that input to represent the in-stream retention factors. Very nice. So one of the earliest models that I made was a publication in 1995. And it was a model for Europe. And it has a very simple approach. It has an agricultural with livestock numbers and fertilizer use. It has a wastewater treatment plant, because they were talking about the urban wastewater treatment regulations at that time. And there was even a groundwater component. And we made that for nitrogen and phosphorus. And for phosphorus, it was only having some agricultural factors in here and one factor to have to the discharge to the coast. It was a very simple model, but it worked. And it even had a coastal component in it to have potential concentrations calculated to see the change of the concentrations in the coast due to the export of the rivers. It was a nice model, but there were a lot of problems in it, especially for scenarios. You couldn't make a consistent scenario. It was too easy. It was too simple. And we were realizing that. And for example, the potential coastal concentrations, they didn't mean anything in physical reality. So there were all kinds of problems that we encountered. So we decided to create a new model. course, there were some publications in from Utrecht, 2001, 2003, 2005, where we spent a lot of time on the soil compartments and have different denitrification. And this was only for nitrogen. So denitrification and leaching, shallow groundwater and denitrification in that part, deep groundwater, and all those fluxes, they're going to the river. And there you see the factor, it's 30% retention. So, and on the other side, there was also human emissions, so wastewater treatment plants that were installed and deposition. So was a nice model, and this one is a very important one because we took a lot of effort in creating the surface balance for this. A surface soil nutrient budget is calculated as follows. So this model works on a half degree grid cells. Each grid cell consists of various land use types like upland crops, wetland rice, legumes and grass. And it has, the rest is natural areas. So there could be cells with only natural areas, and there could be cells with some parts agricultural soils. And you can calculate all the inputs, like fertilizer, but you have to decide for the total fertilizer which is given per country, how to disaggregate that on that cell level and to which crops. The animal manure is also a difficult task to provide because you want to have, if you're changing the diet, as we were told, you need less animals. So, but you want to feed the people. So if you change less animals means less agricultural land or less grassland, it all has consequences. Atmospheric deposition and of course biological and fixation. And as output, there is the crop production, so the uptake, and there's also the grass eaten by the animals, and the ammonia fertilization. For example, if you use animal manure, you can store it in storage. You have some fertilization of ammonia. When you spread it to the crops, you have fertilization, or when you have fertilizer, it will also go to the air. And the resulting factor is the budget, as inputs minus outputs. So the last example is a more integrated assessment where we have a part where there is a soil department and have a more complicated in-stream retention model. And what I present here is just a first step towards this kind of models. So, and of all those concepts, those four concepts, each model is good. There's no bad model in that, because as I thought Vincent was already telling, that for each model, it has a purpose. So I want to express that none of these models are bad or good in that case. But the general, so I want to tell something about the model we created to create scenarios, to do kind of stuff. You see the soil budget that we calculated before. There is some wastewater treatment and it's going to the in-stream blocks. There is also other sources like allochthonous organic matter. It's in areas where there's flooding of the river taking place. It takes a lot of organic matter with the river, and you have an extra input of nitrogen and phosphorus. There is also atmospheric deposition, of course, directly on the water. And what we did here was creating the soil budget and other inputs with the integrated assessment, integrated model to assess the global environment. We call it IMAGE. I will come back to that. And the second one is to couple this whole system with an hydrological model, because we are interested in the transport of nutrients and not in the water quality quantity. So we use the expertise of other people and use that. So for that, we use, for example, runoff, there's discharge, And also the volume of water bodies are prescribed by this model. And you get all kinds of the hydrological fluxes from this model. And as last, I want to tell something of the spiraling ecological concept. It's, when I'm talking to the hydrological model, each grid cell, as you see here, has all kinds of water bodies in it. So you could have a reservoir or a dam with a dam. You could have floodplains going around. You could have a wetland, lakes, groundwater, a channel, which every cell has, riparian zone around it, and also upland area. So, and those cells are connected by a river, so the groundwater stays within the cell, and finally the water ends up in the river, and then it's connected and it's transported to the next cell. So that's the way that we connect cells to each other. And of course, on the river there's also deposition and wastewater. So that's nice, coupling a hydrology model with the biochemistry model, but there are some sharp edges to this. One of these is the volume of the lake. So apart from the fact that we only, in the global databases, only 25% of the big lakes we know the depth of, so there's a lot unknown in the lakes. But besides that, the volume of a lake for hydrology people is just the upper part of the water that is streaming through from discharge. It's not the whole water, which is important for biochemistry. So of course, so that's a difference. And also, which reservoir or lake is to be included in the model? If you decide that a reservoir should be included in the model behaves differently, because in lakes, we have options not to let it flood it, than, for example, than rivers. And a cell can only have one state, always a lake, always a river. That's all kind of simplifying things for a global model. The second one is land use, because they come from a totally different history. So they have different basic assumptions of land use. For example, they use tall vegetation, short vegetation. I'm talking about crops. So what's the difference? And most of the hydrological models, they calculate the evapotranspiration of the crops, but mostly they use potatoes. So that's something, of course, time step is a problem, the daily time step, yearly time step. It's and one of the things for Vincent, for example, the lower strata orders are missing. So the global models, they start at strata order 6, something like that. So what to do with the lower strata orders? So, okay, then something about the image model. So the image, you can find all the documentation on an online documentation site from PBL. And the image model is an integrated assessment model. It exists over 30 years, I think, now. It has all kinds of compartments in it. So it has a socio-economic system with agricultural and land use, agricultural economy, livestock system is a part in it. It has an energy supply and demand system. And energy conversion, we mean by, are you using coal, are you using gas, are you using nuclear power, whatever. And all these results in a final land cover and land use, and that goes into the earth system. The earth system has a land compartment where they have crops and grass, hydrological cycle, and of course the nutrient balance, which I like is in the middle of the figure. So, and from that you have impacts on water stress, agricultural impacts, and so on. But for example, there are all kinds of arrows to be drawn. So for example, if you decided to have more hydropower, you need more reservoirs. If you have more reservoirs, it will affect the nutrient cycle. If you, for example, if you change diet, or you have a lot of people going around, you change land use, and that goes everything back. And for example, the use of fertilizer results in N2O emissions that will go back as an emission back into the climate change part. So there are a lot of arrows that you can draw. Not everything is filled up, and the basic part of this is that we use scenario drivers like economy, population, technology, and policies, and see what the result is of this change. So it's a very excellent, it's a good system to calculate all kinds of scenarios. So for now, Image has provided now the SSP1. SSP1 is a scenario which are the new IPCC scenarios for now. So, and one of the markers, one of the five scenarios is made by Image. A scenario is nothing more than storytelling with consistent assumptions, and that's what we're using to fill it up. So, and this work is of the model that we present. The model description is presented in 2005 in geoscientific model development. Source code is included there in the supplementary material. And the model application of the 20th century is in biogeoscience. And all the data of all the sources are also available there. So you can download it and use it. So, looking at this whole system, we started with, for each grid cell, we have this kind of conceptual model defined. So we start with the nutrient and phosphorus budget. And there are all kinds of fluxes. So for example, we have denitrification of in the first meter of the soil. There is sufficient surface runoff. There is going something not for phosphorus, but for nitrogen. Nitrogen is going down to shallow groundwater, going through the riparian zone or not, depending. And it's going to deep ground. So we have two groundwater compartments and a soil compartment, and a kind of unsaturated zone. There's also atmospheric deposition or other direct sources on rivers like that. And then we have a nutrient spiraling concept as an in-stream retention. So I want to walk the way the water walks through this model. I want to start with number one, the nutrient budget. So what I want to explain here, this is a schematic way which you can find on the online documentation of how this module is working. And I want to show that there are a lot of scenario implications that you can use here. So the end result is soil budget of nitrogen and phosphorus. And for example, you have a production system mix, and you can change by extensification or intensification. So you can have the livestock rations, you can change that, which will result in other excretion of the animals. You can have the spreading of manure. Are you doing that or not? Or when do you do that? All kinds of options that you can provide. And of course, the use of fertilizer and the nutrient use efficiency. And of course, also the animal houses. Do you catch all the ammonia that's coming from stables? Do you clear that emission or not? A lot of possibilities just for fun. And one of the things that we don't have in mind is, of course, the nutrients. Pat showed that very, very nice, but I show the regions here. You see an enormous increase of the fertilizer. Left is nitrogen, right is phosphorus. And yeah, you see that, for example, the yellow part is Northern Asia. And there was USSR, or Russia was included in here. And in the 80s, they stopped selling fertilizer because they don't have any money anymore. So that's something that you can see from here. So, and there is a lot of implication. So if you wonder about these numbers, this is in P, and Pat provided in phosphate instead of P. So there are huge differences per region. And also, I think what Pat also saying is that the N2P ratio of fertilizer is going up very rapidly. So the world is starting here and it's going to that from 1970 to 2010. And you see all the regions, they do the same. So it's a problem. If you do all those calculations, you can make, you can show the nutrients soil budget for nitrogen and phosphorus. So for the last century. And what you see here is, for example, the blue areas. I have to be fast, otherwise I will go on. But that means that actually the soil is mining. You have less, there is more crop produced with P than there is available at, that you give at inputs. So there's a minus. And yeah, for you see clearly there's a lot of change going on and it's going up and down. For Europe, you see in the later years, you see that it's really going down the soil budget. So they have some measurements that helps. So now I want to show something about the denitrification of the soil processes, just quick. So above, it's for nitrogen, it's the denitrification. And you see clear difference, huge denitrifications in India, and of course in the Arctic parts, it's less denitrification. So that's nice. In the lower part, you see the legacy of phosphorus. So it's if you take the soil budgets every year and accumulate that over time. What you see here is, for example, the blue areas, which will be light blue and Africa. It means that they're constantly mining their soils. So what that means for food production, I don't know, but it's not. I don't think it's good news. On the other hand, there's a lot of areas where they have a lot of surplus of phosphorus. So if it's too much, it will lead to an environmental problem or not. That depends on management. So now I want to talk something about number three, that's the direct inputs to the rivers. And I took as example, I took the wastewater model. So just a quick show, there are population, there is food to be consumed, and for phosphorus we also have detergents. They all combine to emission per person. And then there is a decision whether you will have a sewer or not. If you don't have a sewer, it will go directly to one of the three. Agriculture, you can put it on agricultural land. You can have it, you can throw it directly into surface water, or you can do something other. We call it other, but that can mean everything. So it could also mean air if you are possible to do it. So for example, the, here, this is sweat of hair. It's a few percent of people that's going to the air, for example. And there is also, you can have a sewer, and then you still have the decision, I'm going to treat it or I'm not going to treat it. The treatment, you can come back to the treated water, can go to surface water, and for example, the sludge, we define other, because we don't, on a global scale, we don't know what is happening with the sludge. This is a submodel that we use, and you fill in population numbers, you fill in the measurements that it will take, the treatment, and so on, and they will have an answer to the excretion to or the effluent to the wastewater. Of course, there is also industry and animals in the urban areas, but I'm not showing this. You can show the results, and we only apply this for urban areas. So what you see is small dots of cells that have an urban area, and you see that it's growing through time. And it is published by Morey et al. So I think, it's a nice thing of looking at it. But you see this is also increasing very rapidly through the years. Now I want to show some of the results from all the fluxes that go into the surface water. So this is a representation of a global load going to the rivers, to the water bodies. And it's the below it's P, is phosphorus, up is nitrogen, it's going up from 35 or something, going to 55 or even 60. And for the phosphorus, it's going from 4.5 up to 8. And you see atmospheric deposition is the upper red dots. There is aquaculture, it's very little. Sewage, that is the point sources. This is the flooding of areas where they're flooded and take along of organic material with them. And there are four blue lines. One is groundwater on agricultural areas. You see that there's a lot of expansion on the below agricultural soils and natural soils, of course, and the same holds for surfacial runoff. This one is the ground, it is the agricultural soil and the natural soils. The same holds for this, instead of this one is weathering. And also these processes we all took into place in this model. This is another representation of the same, but nice thing is to look at this. So the green area, the green contribution is natural sources, and the blue one is the agricultural, the anthropogenic sources. And you see a huge increase, and yeah, and you see that's over the world, it's everywhere, it's different. So now number five, that's the in-stream retention. So one of the things that has happened the last century is the building of dams. We used the Grand database. You see the picture of the year 2000, but that wasn't the case, of course, in 1900. So in 1900, there were only a few reservoirs available. So what you can see here is that the reservoirs are put into place when they are built in the system. And when this is built, you see that the travel time of water is becoming longer. And if it's becoming longer, a general rule for retention is that the longer the residence time, the more retention will take place. So you see that below for phosphorus in this case, aggregated to river basin. But we do that, of course, on a grid scale. So how do we do that, this kind of retention? We use the spiraling ecological concept, and it's using the spiraling technique. That's, and the length of the spiraling technique is that it's the distance that a molecule is laying, or is the distance is going from water column going to the benthic area. There it stays a little bit and then goes back to the bent to the water column again. And we use this kind of formula with, of course, the residence time in it and the depth from the rivers or lakes. We use that for lakes, reservoirs, and rivers. If you do this, you can show at every grid cell in your system, you can look upstream and say, okay, which sources are the main source from this point in the river? And this is what you see here. So again, above is nitrogen, below is phosphorus, and what you can see is the red one is aquaculture. It happens a few cells in China in the late 2000. But there is also the purple one is point sources. You see that especially in the phosphorus deposition, which is ridiculous, of course, for the Caspian Sea, because Caspian Sea is in Andorraic Lake in perspective of hydrologic, and so everything vanished, so only atmospheric deposition stays over. So, but okay, at some place in the atmospheric deposition, vegetations are the flood areas, especially in Amazon and Congo, for example, the Congo River, and erosion and groundwater. Erosion, that's a general name for superficial surface runoff in this case. But you see nice, the system behave different, there are different sources. That's, I think it's important. So you can aggregate all these outflows from all the rivers, you can aggregate it to ocean and see what is happening. So left above is for nitrogen. All the graphs for nitrogen have the same y-axis, and for phosphorus they also have the same y-axis. What you see here is the Pacific Ocean, which is actually this part and including this part because the world is round, and has a huge increase after 1950, and the Atlantic is going down a little bit. And for phosphorus we have the same. So to support PET a little bit, we can also look at the NP ratios of this. And even here you see that there is a lot of increase of the Pacific, and that means that that the NP ratio is changing, the chemical forms are changing, so the ecosystem is changing. So are we ready now? Because yeah, we have the export. Oh no, that's it. No, I just want to say something about calibration and non-calibration. This model is not calibrated. So there's no, we only looked at the processes, we think that the process is how we think that we are, and just put everything in place and run the model. So for this, what you see here is Mississippi and the Rhine and the discharge. So that's actually a test whether the hydrological model is working. And the dots are from 1974 or something to 2000. And that's the same for here. I think this is a reasonable good result for a global model to have a point in the river to compare this. So we can also do that for the nitrogen and phosphorus concentrations. So what you see here, the light blue lines are the actual data. So it's, I think it's every 2 weeks. And this data is thanks to the USGS that they provide the data online. So that's wonderful. And what you see, this the light blue line is the yearly average made out of the measurements. And the black line is the model, the modeled result. So for phosphorus, well, it's very good for something, but for nitrogen, I think it's much too high. So, but by not calibrating, you can find out what the problem is. So we were talking with Cass Kasman about nitrogen fixation of soybeans, and it appears that the Mississippi has a lot of soybeans in its basin. So for that, we discussed this N fixation and we corrected the method for calculating the N fixation for soybeans, and then you get this result. I think this is in the right order of magnitude. So this is the black lines is the simulation. I think this is fairly good for a global model without doing anything. Of course, I have also better examples, and you can all read that in the article, but this is for the Rhine. Above its nitrogen and its phosphorus. So, and are we ready now? No, because there is also some input directly into the coast. And what I want to present here is the submarine groundwater discharge. Of course, this is only to the coast and not to the internal lakes, so which we are missing, of course. But as you see, there are a lot of hotspots here about the submarine groundwater discharge. So why is this so important? Because there's no phosphorus in it. There's silica, there's nitrogen, but no phosphorus in it. So you get extreme different ratios, which could lead to environmental problems. Of course, marine aquaculture PET showed that already, so don't have to talk about that. And of course, deposition, but that's dependent on the area that you specify, which is the coast, so don't want to present that. So how much time do I have? So it's finished and?
Yeah, about a minute.
A few minutes?
1 minute. 1 minute?
I want to do the carbon cycle, want to do the silica cycle, and of course scenarios, but the scenarios that I don't want to discuss. This is a result for the same as the delivery to the rivers with the scenarios from 2000 to 2050. So. And you see that the aquaculture is coming up here. So that's one of the things. We are working on dynamic biochemistry in the rivers. And this is for the Mississippi, some places where we first started with suspended sediments, because if we can do that, we can do something about total phosphorus. Also the phosphorus here, the same figures as that, and with tank from the USGS. And of course, the nitrogen is there. And what we also can do is look at historical pea export versus the occurrences of hypoxia. But there's no time for that. So I want to conclude. This is my conclusion, and I will leave it to that.